are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I'll be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, though, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you are blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely to spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 60, and in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 1, from the section related to the public ministry of Jesus. We will read today numbers 16, 17, and 18. 16. Jesus with Eliud in the leper settlement. I saw Jesus journeying with Eliud in a southwesterly direction from Nazareth, but not exactly on the high road. He wanted to go to Chim, a leper settlement. They reached it at daybreak, and I saw that Eliud tried to restrain Jesus from entering it, that he might not be defiled. For as Eliud urged, if it were discovered that he had been there, he would not be allowed to go to the baptism. But Jesus replied that he knew his mission, that he would enter, for there was in it a good man who was sighing for his coming. They had to cross the Kishon. The leper settlement lay near a brook formed by the waters of the Kishon, which flowed into a little pond in which the lepers bathed. The water thus used did not return into the Kishon. This settlement was perfectly isolated. No one ever approached it. The lepers dwelt in scattered huts. There were no others in the place, excepting those that attended the infected. Eliud remained at a distance and waited for the Lord. Jesus entered one of the most remote huts, wherein lay stretched on the ground a miserable creature, entirely enveloped in sheets. He was a good man. I have forgotten how he contracted leprosy. Jesus addressed him. He raised himself and appeared to be deeply touched at the Lord's deigning to visit him. Jesus commanded him to rise and stretch himself in a trough of water that stood near the hut. He obeyed while Jesus held his hands extended over the water. The rigid limbs of the leper relaxed and he was made clean. He then resumed his ordinary dress, and Jesus commanded him not to speak of his cure until he should have returned from the baptism. He accompanied Jesus and Eliud along the road till Jesus ordered him to go back. I saw Jesus and Eliud the whole day journeying toward the south through the valley of Esdraelon. Sometimes they conversed together and at others walked apart as if in prayer and meditation. The weather was not very pleasant at that time, the sky dark and fog in the valley. Jesus had no stick. He never carried one, but Eliud had one with a little shovel on it, like those of the shepherds. Jesus wore only sandals, though a kind of perfect shoe, consisting of a thick, woven upper of coarse cotton, was in use at the time. Once I saw Jesus and Eliud at noon resting by a well and eating bread. 17. Jesus transfigured before Eliud. During the night, I saw them again walking, sometimes together, sometimes separate, and then I witnessed something extraordinary, an unspeakably lovely vision. While Jesus was walking on ahead, Eliud passed some remarks upon the symmetry and beauty of his person. Jesus replied, "If thou shouldst behold this body 2 years hence, thou wouldst find in it neither beauty nor symmetry, so greatly will they abuse and maltreat me." But Eliud understood not his words. Above all, he could not comprehend why Jesus always spoke of his kingdom as existing so short a time, for he thought 10 or even 20 years must elapse before it would be founded. He could not bring himself to think otherwise, since his thoughts were all of an earthly kingdom. When they had gone on a short distance, Jesus paused and bade Eliud, who was following lost in thought, to approach, and he would show him who he was, of what nature was his body, and of what kind his kingdom. Eliud drew near to within several steps of Jesus. Then Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and prayed. A cloud, like those seen in a thunderstorm, descended and enveloped both. From without, they could not be seen, but over them opened a heaven of light, which seemed to descend toward them. Above, I saw a city of shining walls. I saw the heavenly Jerusalem. The whole interior was lit up with a rainbow-colored light. I saw a figure like God the Father and Jesus, his form perfectly luminous and transparent, connected with him by beams of light. Eliud stood a while gazing upward, as if entranced, and then sank prostrate on his face, in which position he remained until the apparition and the light had melted away. Then Jesus resumed his way, and Eliud followed speechless and frightened by what he had seen. It was a vision like the Transfiguration, but I did not see Jesus lifted up. I think Eliud did not live to see the crucifixion of Christ. Jesus was more confidential toward him than toward the apostles, for Eliud was very enlightened and very familiar with many of the mysteries connected with the family of Jesus. Jesus took him as a friend and companion, and clothed him with authority so that he did much for his community. He was one of the best instructed of the Essenes. In Jesus' time, the Essenes did not dwell all together on the mountains as formerly. They were more scattered throughout the cities. I had that wonderful vision about 12 o'clock at night. In the morning, I saw Jesus and Eliud arrive at a shepherd field. It was daybreak, and the shepherds were already out of their huts and with the cattle. They came forward to meet Jesus, who was known to them. They cast themselves down before him and then led him and his companions under a shed where they had their cooking utensils. Here they washed their feet, prepared for them a couch, and set before them bread and little drinking cups. They roasted some turtle doves for their guests. The birds had their nests in the roofs of the hut and were hopping around in great numbers like hens. And now I saw Jesus dismissing Eliud, who knelt to receive his blessing. The shepherds were present. Jesus told him that he would end his days in peace, that the path which he himself had to walk would be too difficult for him, that he had admitted him to his community, that he had already done his part in the vineyard, and that he should receive his reward in his kingdom. Jesus explained this by the parable of the laborers in the vineyards. Eliud was very grave, since the vision of the preceding night, very silent and deeply impressed. I think he was afterward baptized by the disciples. He accompanied Jesus a part of the way from the shepherd field. The Lord embraced him, and he departed with signs of manly emotion. The place to which Jesus was going for the Sabbath could be seen from here. Some of his relatives once dwelt there. The place to which he now went alone was called Gur. It was built on a mountain. Joseph's brother, who afterward removed to Zebulun and who had had frequent communication with the Holy Family, once dwelt there. Jesus went unnoticed to an inn where they washed his feet and presented him food. He had a chamber to himself. He caused a roll of the scriptures to be brought to him from the synagogue, and out of it he read and prayed, sometimes standing, sometimes kneeling, often raising his eyes toward heaven. He did not go to the school. Once I saw some people going to the inn and asking to speak to Jesus, but he would not see them. 18. A glance at the disciples going to the baptism. I saw the disciples whom Jesus had dispatched with messages arrive in Capernaum. They were about five of the best known. They had an interview with Mary and then two of them went to Bethsaida for Peter and Andrew, James the Less, Simon, Thaddeus, John, and James the Greater were present. The disciples spoke of the mildness, meekness, and wisdom of Jesus, while the followers of John the Baptist proclaimed with enthusiasm the austere life of their master, and declared that they had never before heard such an interpreter of the law and the prophets. Even John spoke enthusiastically of the Baptist, although he already knew Jesus. His parents had once lived only a couple of hours from Nazareth, and Jesus loved him even as a child. The disciples celebrated the Sabbath here. The next day, I saw the nine disciples along with those named above on the road to Tiberias, whence they were to go to John, passing near Ephron, and then through the desert toward Jericho. Peter and Andrew particularly distinguished themselves by the zeal with which they spoke of the Baptist. He was, they said, of a noble priestly race. He had been educated by the Essenians in the wilderness. He would suffer no irregularity around him. He was as rigorous as he was wise. Then Jesus' disciples put forward the mildness and wisdom of their master, to which the others retorted that many disorders arose from such condescension, and they cited instances and proof of what they said. Jesus' disciples replied that their master too had been educated by the Essenians, and that moreover he had but lately returned from traveling. But John entered not into this discussion. I did not hear him say anything more in that strain. They started together for the place of baptism, but after a few hours took different directions. As I listened to their conversation, I thought, men were then as they now are. This brings us to the close of our reading today, and so I'll offer now a few words of reflection upon what we have just read in sections 16, 17, and 18. So we hear about the leper settlement. Just yesterday, I was speaking about how leprosy was more prevalent than I would have imagined or anticipated. And then our very next reading about a leper settlement. Jesus wants to go in. Eliud tells him, maybe you shouldn't. Jesus says, but I know my mission and I know someone is there waiting for me. And so Jesus goes in. Jesus knew his mission. Do you know your mission? It's a good question to take away from Jesus knowing his. He knows his mission from the Father to become the sacrifice. What's our mission? In number 17, we had Eliud becoming a witness of the transfigured Jesus. Jesus spoke about his body. He said, they will greatly abuse and maltreat me. So here you have Jesus, 3 years before his public, before his crucifixion. He already knows what's going to happen. Could it be the suffering servant of Isaiah? Maybe. But Jesus knows because he's God. He knows what is coming and what is expected. And so he tells Eliud, they will abuse and maltreat me. Eliud just can't grasp this heavenly kingdom. He keeps thinking about things in this worldly context, about an earthly kingdom. This is why Jesus transfigures himself before Eliud so that he could understand a little bit more the glory of who Jesus is. And then we hear this sentence, I think Eliud did not live to see the crucifixion of Christ. This is only going to happen a few years later from this, but Eliud doesn't live to see the crucifixion. And then finally, Eliud concludes his time with Jesus. The Lord embraced him and he departed with signs of manly emotion. Whatever that means, whatever that looks like. An interesting statement at the end of number 17, too. Once I saw some people going to the inn and asking to speak to Jesus, but he would not see them. That's just something maybe to sit with, ponder over, mull over. Why would Jesus choose not to enter into conversation with someone? Was it because he knew that they didn't have good intentions, that they were just curious seekers and not really interested? Because remember, Jesus is all-knowing. He knows everything. We know from the scriptures that he knows what people are thinking even before they ask it, what they're arguing about, even though he's not there. So Jesus knows when these people come. And so maybe it's in that knowledge of what he knows about what they will ask that he realizes that he need not answer it. Jesus, what he does, and I would say even what he doesn't do, it has a purpose, it has a meaning. And then a glance at the disciples going to the baptism. They're on their way. I kind of find it interesting, you know, that these disciples who would become apostles, that these are ones Jesus already has drawn them a little bit. They want to go with him to the baptism. So they're present there. Just kind of gives you a different perception of the early public ministry of Jesus. And we'll continue our reading tomorrow. But I kind of chuckled internally, and maybe you did, at the last line. As I listened to their conversation, I thought, men were then as they now are. Essentially, she's saying, even hundreds of years ago, men are still the same. Kind of comical. This brings us to a close of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Please share this podcast with others. Share it with your family, text it to your friends, send a message out to your prayer group, let them know you're listening, and encourage them to join you so that you can have holy conversations with them about these writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.